Hello everyone, this is Bharat Jain. I am lecturer at Sahyadri PU College Science. Today I am here to deal with a well-known second PU class 12 chapter called Electrochemistry. Well, the basically electrochemistry means is a branch of chemistry. As one of the branch of a chemistry, it deals with interconversion of two energy forms. One is electrical energy, another one is chemical energy. It means according to law of conservation of energy, what it says, energy neither be created nor be destroyed, but one form of energy can be converted into another form, or we can say energy of the universe remains constant. According to that, when we consider two energy forms, electrical energy and chemical energy, these two energy forms can be interchanged, which means electrical energy can be converted into chemical energy and chemical energy can be converted back to electrical energy. So we considered interconversion of two energy forms, that is electrical energy and chemical energy. These interconversions are studied under the title electrochemistry. Well, what is the basis for these interconversion means a spontaneous redox reaction. Spontaneous redox reactions are the basis for these interconversions. Here, spontaneous redox reaction, meaning spontaneous usually refers to the one which takes place by its own without any external aid. They are referred as spontaneous. Further, we are saying redox reaction. So here, redox reactions, these are a kind of chemical reactions. Actually, in practice, is a combination of two different form of reactions. That is, as we said, name redox, REDOX. This R-E-D is taken from a chemical phenomenon called reduction. And OX is taken from a chemical phenomenon named oxidation, which means redox reaction is a combination of two phenomena. One is reduction, another one is oxidation. Well, here, what is the meaning of reduction and oxidation? So, according to electronic concept, reduction means it is the gain of addition of one or more electron to a chemical species. On the other hand, oxidation refers to it is the loss of one or more electrons by a chemical species, which means in a redox reaction, what happens? One of the chemical species are going to lose electron while another chemical species is going to accept the electron, which means during a redox reaction, electrons are being transferred from one chemical species to another chemical species. Well, if electrons are transferred, it means electrons are moving from one chemical species to another chemical species, which means that movement of electrons is going to generate electrical energy, which means a spontaneous redox reactions are the basis for interconversion of these two forms, electrical energy into chemical energy and vice versa. Well, what type of materials are taken for the interconversions? Whether all materials can be used here? No. A substances called conductors. Conductors, these are the substances which conduct electrical charge. Therefore, those substances are used for the study of interconversions. So we say conductors, the substances which conduct electric charge. Say again here, irrespective of its nature, if it conduct electric charge, then it is called conductors. Well, examples for these, all metals, we know that metals conduct electric charge, hence metals can be named as a conductors. Further, there are solutions, that is we call electrolytic solutions are also conduct electricity, so that we can say all metals can be named as a conductors, and even electrolytic solutions, commonly I can say electrolytic solutions, can also be used as a conductors. Now coming to the nature, if I consider nature of a conductors, all conductors are not alike, they are not same. When I compare properties of a metals with the properties of these solutions, they are totally different. So based on the nature of those conductors, conductors are of two types. Conductors can be categorized into two types. First one, metallic conductors, they are also named as electronic conductors, and the second one, electrolytic conductors. So based on the nature, conductors are of two types. First one, metallic conductors, second one, electrolytic conductors.
Coming to the first type, that is metallic, or they are also called electronic conductors. So here, metallic meaning metals, means metals are act as a conductor here. So what are these metallic conductors, or you can say electronic conductor, means, so these are the substances which allow the passage of electric current through it. It means they are conductors which allow the passage of electric current through it by the movement of electrons. How they conduct electricity here? They conduct electricity by the movement of electrons without mass transfer. It means during metallic conduction what happens? They conduct electricity by the movement of electrons without mass transfer. Means there is no any change in the mass, or I can say there is no any chemical change takes place. It just involves the movement of electrons. So metallic definition, the substances which allow the passage of electric current through it by the movement of electrons is the first thing to be remembered. Further, without mass transfer means during metallic conduction there is no any chemical change. Okay, examples, metals are the example for metallic conductors. So example, metals like copper, silver, gold are well known example for metallic conductors. Here when you think of these three, copper, silver and gold, regarding the usage, which is used most frequently, means copper is used, why not silver and gold are used, not commonly used as a conductor, means because of their expensive nature. So we use copper but not silver and gold for. Then come to the second type, electrolytic conductors, they are also called ionic conductors. Well, electrolytic conductor, so electrolyte means, in case of electrolytic conductors, electrolytes act as a conductor. Well, electrolyte, these are the substances which undergo dissociation in a, either in their molten state or in their aqueous phase, or else even you can say in their phase in a suitable solvent. Means when a substance undergo dissociation in any kind of medium, they are named as a electrolytes. Further, when that electrolyte is added to the suitable solvent, that resultant solution if it conduct electricity, then it is considered as a electrolytic conductor. So here, electrolytic conductor, there are possibilities. They may conduct electricity either in their molten state, or they even conduct electricity in their aqueous solution. Means we have possibility here. They conduct electricity either in the molten state or in the aqueous solution. So definition, the substances which conduct electricity either in their molten state or in aqueous solution is called electrolytic conductors, or even they are called ionic conductors, are simply named electrolytes. Well, that electrolytic conductors may be acids, it may be bases, or it may be salts. So acids, commonly used as acids, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, bases, sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, and salt solutions like sodium chloride, ammonium chloride. Okay. Well, we consider two type of conductors. First one, metallic conductors, and second one, electrolytic conductors. Metallic conductor, what we can say? These are the substances which allow the passage of electric current by the movement of electrons without mass transfer. Examples, metals. On the other hand, second, what is that? Electrolytic conductor. These are the substances which conduct electricity either in their molten state or else in their aqueous solution, are called electrolytic conductors. Example, commonly electrolytic solutions, or you can say acids, bases and salts. Now coming to the differences between these metallic and electrolytic conductors. As we said, two types of conductors means there must be some differences. So we can list out four major differences between metallic conductors and electrolytic conductors. These are the four noticeable differences between metallic and electrolytic conductors. Well, coming to the first point of difference. In case of metallic conductor, as we already mentioned, in metallic conductors, metallic conductivity. So here, conductivity is due to mobility of a free electrons. How they conduct electricity? They conduct electricity by the movement of electron. So we say conductivity is due to mobility of free electrons. On the other hand, electrolytic conductivity is due to mobility of free ions towards oppositely charged electrodes. So it's the one difference. Metallic conductors, conduction is due to mobility of free electrons, while electrolytic conductor, conductivity is due to mobility of free ions. This is the first point of difference. Second, during metallic conduction, it does not involve the transfer of matter. As we already mentioned in the definition, without mass transfer, it means there is no any change in the mass during conduction. So we say it does not involve the transfer of matter. But electrolytic conductor, what happens? It involves the transfer of matter. Why we are saying means, say during electrolytic conduction, what happens? The conductivity is due to mobility of free ions. Means ions are being transferred, they are moving. When electrolyte is added to suitable solvent, it splits into constituent atoms. Means there will be large number of cations and anions will be formed. Once ions present are formed, they started moving. When we apply potential difference, ions started moving towards oppositely charged electrodes. That is, anions move towards anode, while cations move towards cathode. When they move, they reach the electrode surface. At electrode surface, they undergo chemical changes. Means, chemical changes includes, that is, oxidation and reduction. That is, they undergo primary changes, give primary product. If primary products are unstable, they undergo secondary changes to give secondary product. Means it continues till to end up with a stable product formation. Which means during electrolytic, overall what we can say, during electrolytic conduction, what happens? There involves a transfer of matter. So metallic conduction, it doesn't involve the transfer of matter, while electrolytic conductors, here it involves the transfer of a matter. This is the second point of difference. Coming to the third point, what happens here? Passage of current does not bring any chemical change. Means that metal remains same, there is no any chemical change, net chemical change. But during electrolytic conduction, what happens? Passage of current brings chemical changes. As I said here, ions undergo primary changes to give primary product, secondary changes to give secondary product. It means they are undergoing certain reactions like oxidation and reduction. So that is considered as a chemical change. So third difference, passage of current does not bring chemical change in metallic conductors, but passage of current brings chemical change in case of electrolytic conductors. Then come to the last point of difference. In case of metallic conductors, what happens? With increasing temperature, metallic conduction decreases. While in case of electrolytic conductors, with increasing temperature, conduction increases. So these are the four points of differences between metallic and electrolytic conductors. Okay. Come to the next. When you think of electrolyte, as I said, electrolytic solution, electrolytes are used there. It may be acids, base, or some salt solutions are used as a electrolytic conductors. Now here, as you come across electrolyte, as I already mentioned, electrolyte, these are the substances or the compounds which undergo dissociation in solution phase or any suitable solvent. So based on the extent of dissociation. It means all electrolytes do not dissociate to the same extent. Some electrolytes they dissociate more, some electrolytes they dissociate less, and there are some compounds which doesn't dissociate at all. Means there is a change in the extent of dissociation. So we say based on the extent of dissociation, those electrolytes are categorized into two types: strong electrolytes and a weak electrolyte. Here, strong doesn't mean having more energy; it just means complete dissociation. Similarly, weak doesn't mean having less energy. Here, weak refers to undergoing partial dissociation. So we can say the definitions: strong electrolyte, the compound which undergo complete dissociation in the solution phase. Strong meaning the compounds which undergo complete dissociation in solution phase are called strong electrolytes. On the other hand, weak electrolyte, these are the compounds which undergo partial dissociation in the solution phase are called weak electrolyte. So I hope you got the difference here. Strong meaning the compounds which undergo complete dissociation, weak electrolyte which means which undergo partial dissociation. So electrolyte, so what are the types of electrolyte? Means electrolytes can be categorized into two types. What is the basis? Based on the extent of dissociation. There are two types: strong electrolyte and weak electrolyte. What is to be remembered? Strong electrolyte, complete dissociation; weak electrolyte, partial dissociation. Well, as I mentioned, there are some compounds which doesn't undergo dissociation in solution phase. They remains in its molecular form. Say like glucose, benzene, urea. When these substances are added into any kind of solvent, they remain in their molecular form. There is no any kind of dissociation, and there is no any kind of ion formation. So such kind of compounds, if the compound does not undergo dissociation in solution phase, they are named as non-electrolyte. The compounds which does not undergo dissociation in solution phase are called non-electrolyte. Examples I mentioned: glucose, urea, benzene. These are the well-known examples for non-electrolyte. Well, when I think of, say, a strong electrolyte, say sodium chloride is added to water, we got a sodium chloride solution. Sodium chloride solution conducts electricity. It conducts electricity. Therefore, I call sodium chloride is a conductor. Sodium chloride solution acts as an electrolytic conductor. Similarly, say acetic acid. When acetic acid is added to water, I got a solution, acetic acid solution. That acetic acid solution also conducts electricity. Means solution of strong electrolyte, solution of weak electrolyte, both conduct electricity. It may be solution of a strong or it may be solution of a weak electrolyte, both conduct the electricity. But on the other hand, if I go for solution of a non-electrolyte, there is no ions, hence it doesn't conduct the electricity. These two, solution of strong as well as solution of weak electrolyte, they contain ions. Ions are moving towards oppositely charged electrolytes, therefore they conduct electricity. But in case of solution of a non-electrolyte, there is no any ion. They remain in their molecular form, there is no any movement of ions, hence there is no conduction. So based on this concept, non-electrolyte can also be defined. Another definition: the compound which does not conduct electricity. What we are saying? The compounds which does not conduct electricity either in water state or in aqueous solution. The compound which does not conduct electricity either in water state or in aqueous solution, they are called non-electrolytes. So for non-electrolyte, there are two definitions. We can define any of the form. The compound which does not conduct electricity either in molten state or in aqueous solution is called non-electrolyte. Or else, simply what we can say, the compound which does not undergo dissociation in solution phase is called non-electrolyte. So it is regarding classification of electrolyte and the definition for non-electrolyte.